I saw something. I was at work and my patients were sleeping. So I whipped up my handy dandy iPad, thanks to my brother, because mine was stolen in Haiti. I turned on the iPad and I saw President Obama make a statement. And he said that gay marriage was okay. And you know, if that's what he believes, there's no problem. I have zero problem with that. In fact, my idea is if you want to be gay, it's your business. It's between you and God. I'm not going to force you to do anything. If you want to drink, you know the right and wrong, and I'll help you, I'll pray for you. But I'm not going to condemn you, because I got a lot of faults myself. And I can't judge you, but I can sit down and pray with you. So I'm not going to judge you. So I'm listening to him. And he made the statement that he supported gay marriage, and then it was okay. That's all. I figured he would say something like that. And then he made this other statement. And I was listening. He says, as Jesus Christ suffered, they suffered. And as Christians, we should know their suffering. And I started realizing that something was amiss. And then I turned off the computer, and something spoke to me, and I believe it was God spoke to me, saying that too many men are changing the world. See, I'm not telling you right now to vote for Obama or not. I'm using it as an example, especially people on the internet to hear me. I'm not saying yes or no. I'm just doing it because it's on the news everywhere. Now, what this brings you, I've passed out a paper to everybody, and on the internet, I'll have a PDF file for you to see what it looks like. Now, the topic of this is, man is not to change what God says. Man does not have the authority to change the will of God on any subject. We have been given many severe warnings in the places in the Bible concerning any changes we try to make to God's word. But let me clarify, making a change in God's word is saying something different than what is written. For example, if I was in the Marine Corps like I used to be, and I loved the whole Marine Corps, but for some strange reason, I hated the uniform. So I decided one day I was going to wear an Air Force uniform. And I decided to follow all the rules but that one rule. The Marine Corps would not look highly upon that. Maybe all these Marines standing there in their Marine Corps uniform, and here's this one idiot standing in an Air Force uniform. And they would say to me, you're not a Marine if you do that. And I'm like, I followed all the rules, I just didn't like that rule. And they say, here's what's going to happen. You're going to be kicked out of the Marine Corps because we don't want you in the Marine Corps because you're making your own rules. We make the rules, not you. You wanted to become one of us, so you follow our rules. You don't like the rule, so be it. If the Marine Corps says you come in at 11 o'clock because you're enlisted E3 or below, when you're out on float, guess what that means? You come back to the barracks at 11 o'clock. And if you're an officer, you can stay till 6 a.m. But that's the rules. You don't have to like it. And if you don't like it, you can leave it. Well, after your enlistment's over, you know, because there are consequences. And that's the same as the Bible. And the other example is, if you go into a garage and you pull out a chair and you sit in the middle of the garage, you are not going to become a car. It's just not going to happen. You can sit there all day and night. You're still not going to become a car. I don't care what you do. You cannot break that rule. Maybe, just maybe, someone lets you wear the Air Force uniform for some strange reason, but you'll never become a car. Now, how does that relate to what I'm speaking about? If you change what is written in the Bible, it is no longer the Bible. If God says whatever in the Word, there's a lot of things, and you don't agree with it, you don't say, well, I'm going to throw that out. What you have done, in effect, is you have made your own God. It is not the God of Jacob and Abraham and Isaac. It is another God of your own making. because your God doesn't like the rules that you don't like. Well, I hate to break it to all the people in the world, God did not ask our permission or what rules to make. He didn't ask us whether we liked the things He did. He made us, therefore He does what He wants. A manufacturer of a car, you go buy a Chevrolet. They don't call you up usually and say, how should I make the car? Either you like the car and you buy it, and you accept how it is, and if you don't like it, you get rid of it. And maybe they'll change their rules. But a lot of times they spend a lot of money, so they don't change it. They're like, hey, there's other cars here. I don't care if I lose you as a customer. Even though they say they don't, but they don't care. Now, in the Bible, concerning any changes we try to make to God's Word, we've already established and seen that the Word has said that you cannot change a dotted I. Now that means we can't change any doctrine or whatever God says. And I'll give you an example of something about me. Now, you know the situation with Israel and Palestine. They're fighting. It's God's land. It is His chosen children. The Bible says we have to support Israel. The Bible doesn't say you have to agree with Israel. The Bible doesn't say you have to want to agree. I think, in the back of my perverted mind, that maybe they should get along and share the land. That's not for me to make that decision. God said support His children. He did not say change the rules and make it what you want, Ian, which is me. And so I do what the Bible says. It doesn't matter. God did not ask my permission or my ideas on His thoughts. His thoughts are grander than ours. He knows the whole picture. Maybe there's something in line for the Palestinians. I don't know. And if God wanted me to know, He would let me know. But obviously He didn't let me know, so it's not time for me to know. Maybe I can't handle it. Like the movie says, you can't handle the truth. Maybe I can't handle it. But be that as it may, God said support them, so I support them. I don't ask why they did it. I support whatever they do because they are God's children. Any such warning comes in the closing verses of the Bibles in Revelations, chapter 22, 18-19. Says, for I testify unto everyone who hears the words of this prophecy of this book, for anyone who adds these things, God will add him the plagues that are written in the book. And if anyone takes away from the words of this book, of this prophecy, God shall take away his part in the book of life, and from the holy city, and from things that are written in this book. These are very stern warnings. What it's saying is if you change the Bible, you threw away your salvation. Because now you're worshiping a different God. I'm going to go into a little more detail here in a minute. How much stronger warnings could God give to those who try to make changes to His will when they change immersion into sprinkling or change necessity of baptism for one to receive forgiveness of sins and to be saved until the saying of baptism is not necessary for salvation? God has plainly said that you have to accept Him. You can't change that. They also say the one's sins are forgiven, that is, one is saved when he accepts Christ as his personal Savior. What I'm talking about, simply, there are churches, I'm not going to name them, there are churches that said homosexuality is okay. The pastor can bring his boyfriend or his girlfriend to the church and be accepted as the first lady, or I don't know what you call it. But the Bible says it's an abomination. What really is going on here, they have changed the word. They're no longer worshiping out of the Bible. They're worshiping out of something. You can come on in. There's somebody looking through the door. You are now worshiping on a Bible that's a book that's based on the Bible. It's no longer the Bible because it's been changed. Like I was saying, if I wore an Air Force uniform in a Marine formation, the Marines would not like that. Because I changed one rule, one little thing, I am no longer a Marine. And they're going to make sure I don't stay there. Well, God's the same way. If you go and change the word as it's written here, and then you accept to be saved, you know, he's going to say, no. You were saved in your own Bible, in your own way. And now you're going to stand before him on judgment day, and you're going to pay the price. Because you're going to have to answer this question, or this statement. You took things out of the Bible that you didn't like, that you didn't feel comfortable. And then he's going to ask the person standing, but did you write it? No. Did your son offer? No. Therefore, you didn't worship me. You worship an idol. Somebody of your own creation. But here's the thing. That creation can be very close. Very, very close indeed. And this is the scary part. The evil one. Satan. The devil. Whatever you want to call him. He can come in subtle little things. And this is what I'm talking about. Anyone have an NIV Bible with them right now, or a King James Bible? Okay, let me just read this to you. Any King James Bible, if you have a Bible, you can turn to it. Matthew 17, verse 21. If you have a new NIV, New International Version, it will not be there. This is what it says. Howbeit, this kind goeth not but by prayer and fasting. Let me clarify what's going on here. Here, Jesus is talking about faith. If you have the faith the size of a mustard seed, knowing that the mustard seed is the smallest seed in the world, you can move a mountain. And he says it. But then he ends his statement. But some people, the evil one, the Satan, whoever wants, doesn't want you to know this part. And I'll explain why he doesn't want you to know. It says, howbeit this kind goeth but by prayer and fasting. Let me explain this to you. If you wanted to move the mountain, Jesus said what? Move, and the mountain shall move from yonder place. Guess who did that? You did. You told the mountain to move. But if you pray and fast, guess who moved the mountain? God moved the mountain. What it's saying, Jesus is saying here, if you want something done, you need to pray and you need to fast in order to get something done, especially something great. Moving a mountain is not a small feat. There's going to be a lot of damage done. And I, you know, even the mountain move, some trees are going to get hurt. And something's going to move. Your life. You can't. There's so many people says, God got me this car. This is my car. Did you pray for it? No, the Bible didn't say I pray. This is how it is. Little bit things. So I look at this verse, and it tells me I can tell whatever to happen or happen, but I neglected to bring God into the picture. So this little section that's taken out is very powerful. Extremely powerful. I am now telling, meaning the book, NIV, I am now saying you can get what you want by just doing what you want, because I'm giving you the power, but you don't need to recognize God did it. You need to do things by prayer and fasting. This is the reason that you have to be very careful. The Bible says you need to read and learn the Word. And when you read and learn the Word and you study the Word, it says go and fellowship in church. Now, if you're sitting by yourself in front of a TV or just by yourself refusing to go to church, you can get some misconceptions. Also, you can get misconceptions by going to the wrong kind of church. This is where prayer and fasting come in. You need to pray. You ever heard the saying, pray before you read the Bible? Why? God will speak to you. Because remember, even the demons tremble before God. They know God's real.